Hi, I'm John Long, and welcome to Yosemite. There's probably no better place in the world to learn how to rock climb, and I suspect there's a handful of you out there who someday challenge these colossal walls, some of the biggest and best in the world. Now, our class can never hope to replace actual hands-on instruction, because you learn best by doing. We can, however, bring into focus all the fundamentals basic to a safe and enjoyable experience. Our class is based on the Yosemite system, which emphasizes simplicity and safety. And don't be confused by all the knots and terminologies and technology. They all apply to basic, simple principles. Like any other sport, climbing is a matter of grades and degrees. Let's take a look at those.
This then is first class. I need no previous climbing experience to walk from here to the bar to order myself a non-alcoholic beverage.
Second class is essentially moderate hiking. We encounter some kind of terrain, trail perhaps.
We're sliding along a riverbank. Hey, hey, ladies!
I got a road, my car, and I got other things to do too. This is third class. The hands are used for balance. Often the terrain is steep and strenuous. There's no uniform rule when to rope up on this kind of terrain. If you feel more comfortable with the rope, by all means, use it.
Hip rope! Fourth class is when the terrain is steep enough to where a fall may prove to be fatal. Even an experienced climber like myself will often want a rope on fourth class terrain.
Having a good time, but once you get here, you got to bear down. This is fifth class or technical rock climbing, where a rope and equipment are always employed. Our class will focus primarily on fifth class climbing. When the rock becomes too steep to climb using hand or footholds, there is still a select few foolish enough to want to carry on. The method is called sixth class or direct aid climbing, where the equipment absorbs all of my body weight. Mechanically, I ascend this. In reference to beginning rock climbing, sixth class or direct aid is little more than a curiosity. This is it in its most fundamental form. That should be clear enough, eh? The only thing left for us is to go climbing. Climbing down to two basic elements, the physical ascending and the use of equipment to minimize the risk. Before we set boot to rock, and that there is a mighty big rock, let's get familiar with the gear. The most fundamental piece of equipment in fifth class climbing is the rope, the lifeline between the two climbers. Over the years, there's been a dramatic evolution in the quality of the rope, whereas in the past, people used to use yachting ropes, white line, hemp, even on occasion a clothesline, if we're to believe them. The standard rope now is a kern mantle rope, which involves a woven nylon sheath over a braided core. Standard dimensions for the kern mantle rope are 11 millimeters in diameter by 165 feet in length. This rope has tremendous dynamic qualities, which absorb much of the energy when generated in a fall. These ropes do not simply break, though on rare occasions they're known to be cut over a serrated edge or shattered by falling rock. There are three things in particular we have to be conscious of in terms of rope care. The first is never step on the rope because it grinds unnecessary particles into the sheath. Second, do not expose the rope to unnecessary sunlight, which will greatly reduce the strength of the rope over a long period of time. And third, keep chemicals as far away from the rope as you can in terms of gasoline, turpentine, etc. So unless a rope is abused by long falls, chemicals, or unnecessary sunlight, a rope is generally good until the sheath wears through. The simplest and strongest method of tying into the rope is with a swami belt. Complicated harnesses are not necessarily any better and are definitely not stronger. A standard swami belt consists of 3 to 4 wraps of 2-inch
tubular nylon webbing secured with a water knot.
As with other knots you'll soon see, the water knot is a follow-through knot. Here, you tie an overhand knot. Find the end. Now with the free end, you follow the aforementioned end back to the origin. In the end, knots take practice. This video will best serve you as a guide to compare your efforts against. Don't forget to leave yourself a tail. Secure those ends with a half hitch, then slide the whole rig out of harm's way.
Leg loops are used in conjunction with the swimming belt to form a complete harness. Any viable set of leg loops will feature a keeper sling in the back, which keep the loops from slipping down too low.
Since leg loops are reasonably inexpensive, go for a quality pair. If you have to hang in them at all, you'll want a perfect fit, snug, but not constricting. The green sling, then, is the keeper sling. It comes up and over the swimming belt, then clips into the opposite leg. There are virtually hundreds of harnesses on today's market. The key question is, does your harness have a double pass-through buckle, as this one does? If so, make sure that tail passes through the buckle, twice.
In the past, harnesses were cumbersome, uncomfortable, and had design flaws, which resulted in the falling climber being wrenched upside down or sideways when the rope came taut. They also could do grievous damage to a man's private parts. Contemporary designs have eliminated these problems, so essentially, whatever method you choose is a matter of personal choice.
The climber will sometimes find himself lashed to the cliffside in full hang positioning. Here, the swami belt is the worst option, as it puts all the weight on the back. A harness takes that weight off your back and onto the gams, much more comfortable.
We've looked at the swamis, the leg loops, and the harnesses. Let's take a close look at the knot we used to tie in with.
There's one and only one recommended knot to tie into the rope, a double figure eight. Grab the last 2 feet of the cord, make a loop, pass the end around the horn and back down the hole to form a single figure eight. The tail is then passed through the harness, then the end traces the eight configuration back out in reverse. She will now attempt to re-thread a double figure eight, which indeed is a very difficult knot. She's on the back nine, coming around the horn. She's on the fairway now. She's gonna have to pull that tight and hook it right. That's hook it right, a difficult move at this juncture. No, 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 there it is. She's out of the rough, home free. Quite a tee shot there. She's bringing it down, it's in the hole. Remember, this is your one and only tie-in. So for peace of mind, leave yourself enough of a tail to periodically give it a good yank. No, 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 you need a pair of needle-nose pliers to grab that. And ho, Daddy, what's with a loop? Flipper could jump through that. Get that knot close to the harness. Perfecto.
Aside from a rope, a carabiner is the most basic piece of equipment used in rock climbing. In the simplest terms, a carabiner is an aluminum alloy snap link with a spring-loaded gate used to connect various pieces of the climbing chain together, such as a rope to an anchor. They come in all kinds of different configurations, sizes, and dimensions. This one's called an oval. The next most popular model is called a D. That's that one. And they're both used for exactly the same purposes. Under certain rare circumstances, it might be possible, such as when you're pulling a bag up the face of the cliff, that the gate could be forced open by an edge or a rock or whatnot. Under those circumstances and ones like it, you want to use a locking carabiner, which has this device on it, which you spin towards the top of the gate, and that keeps the gate from coming open. Now, one thing you must understand, that a locking carabiner is not necessarily any stronger than an oval or a D or anything else. All it does is ensure that the gate does not come open. The carabiner is constructed to be extremely strong lengthwise, like this. That's the way it is meant to be used. And in that manner, the carabiner is exceptionally strong. Usually you'll find on the gate a number which is punched in. In this instance, it's 2,000 kilograms, which is better than 4,000 pounds. A carabiner is not meant to be pulled out on the gate as such. If you do that,
A carabiner is only as strong as the little pin there that goes into the mouth of the carabiner there. So under no circumstances are you to set this up or any piece of your system so there is direct pull out on the gate. How then do we secure the rope to the cliff? This used to be accomplished with pitons, which were driven into cracks in the rock. As climbing became more popular, a less destructive method of protection had to be devised. The solution, then, was nuts or chalk stones. These are basically tapered pieces of aluminum or metal fitted with a rope sling or wired cable, and these, in turn, are placed in constrictions in the crack. Traditional chalk stones come in two different designs. The first, commonly called a stopper, has a distinctive wedge shape to it. It can be placed either the thin way, like such, or the wide way, as such. When a climber searches for a nut placement, he ideally looks for a constriction in the crack, the taper of which corresponds exactly to the taper of the nut. Generally, the more surface area of nut to rock, the better the placement. The second is called a hexcentric. And owing to the many different angles and sides to it, it affords the climber four distinctive attitudes for placement. One, two, three, and even sideways, four. While stoppers can usually find a ready purchase in appropriate slots, you'll often have to work a little harder to find that perfect hex placement. You'll also want to give hexcentrics a good tug just to set them so the drag of the rope doesn't lift them from the crack. One of the most ingenious and successful inventions in the last 10 years has been the friend. These were originally designed for parallel-sided cracks where traditional nut cannot find purchase. Each of the four lobes or cams work independently of the other. When you pull down on this trigger, the ratio becomes thin. When you ease off, as they are spring-loaded, they fan back out. The ideal friend placement is in a perfectly parallel-sided crack, where the lobes are at mid-range. To remove the friend, simply depress the trigger and lift it on out. If the crack is too big for the lobes tip out. And that ain't no friend at all. Sometimes moving the friend as little as an inch can find that perfect placement. A sling is one of our most fundamental pieces of equipment. Essentially, it's a 5-foot piece of 1-inch tubular nylon webbing secured with a water nut. The runner has many applications and remains the climber's mainstay in securing natural anchors, be it slinging a tree or slinging a flake of rock. Anchor is our method of attaching a rope to the cliff. An old Yosemite ace once told me, if you don't have a great anchor, you ain't got nothing. Our first choice of an anchor is always a natural one, a stout tree or a big block of stone. If unavailable, we must use our equipment to construct an artificial one. Whatever our choice of an anchor is, it must be strong enough to withstand the force of the biggest possible fall. Once Felix has completed his lead, he first eyeballs around for an anchor. Yes, a stout, albeit squatty, Jeffrey Pine. Again, the runner comes into play, and he ties it off nice and low. He'll use not one, but two carabiners. The knot he will use to tie in with is called a figure eight on a bite. Doubled, he forms a loop, it comes around and back down through the hole. When he ties in, he will make sure that the two carabiners have opposing gates. Just a little extra insurance to make sure his anchor is bomb-proof. Another popular knot is the overhand on a bite. A good knot, but a little tougher to untie once it's been weighted. For natural anchors, it's hard to beat a beefy block of rock. To construct an artificial anchor, we find the best section of crack
and employ the appropriate nuts, or in this case, friends. The key here is direction of pull, and we always place the gear with this in mind. Once the anchor has been established, we're left to tie it all together, this usually accomplished with a runner. Now, personally, I think the second nut in that configuration looks a little off. Yeah, there he is, Felix. He's got it right. Bomb-proof. Should we need to equalize the anchors, we simply put a half twist on the runner. Then, we put another half twist on one side. Clip through both sides, and we have a sliding equalizer which distributes the pull from any angle. In constructing an artificial anchor, we most frequently use different pieces of gear. Here, we have an opposition anchor, the bottom nut safeguarding against an upward pull. A bolt is one of the most common forms of fixed anchor. A hole is first drilled, then the split flange stud is driven in. Seemingly infallible, they sometimes fail. So use some common sense before trusting them. Fixed pitons are also common. But even though they may appear bomb-proof, be sure to test them. Again, a bomb-proof anchor is tantamount to safe climbing. Let's look at what happens when it's less than ideal. Felix here is Max. One false move, and he's off big time. Hence, the anchor must be sound, and that one, poor. Ah! Old Felix took a 300-foot fall, and the belayer learned his lesson the hard way. Only fell 50 feet this time.
In the last 10 years, few things have helped revolutionize the sport like these P-rays. The first boot to utilize a super sticky sole which adheres two, maybe even three times better than every boot before them. Rock climbing is a sport specialized enough to where you'll definitely want a pair of shoes. Without them, it's like going ice skating without skates. Nothing hones up your technique and strength faster than bouldering for practicing on small rocks. It's also the fastest way to get hurt because whenever you fall off, you hit the ground. So always keep your eyes peeled for things you can fall onto, and whenever possible, use a spotter.
Bouldering has become so popular that really, it's a separate sport. A climber can max himself and try problems he would never try under normal circumstances. If there's ever any doubt about taking a bad fall, just make sure you use a spotter. Amazing things have been done on the boulders, chiefly because the climber has little worry about the fall. There's any number of ways to do the same problem, too. Top roping. When an anchor is set on top, the rope looks doubled through. One end for the climber, one end for the belayer. When setting up a top rope, make sure the anchor extends over any sharp edge. Extend it with a runner if need be.
Leading is the name of the game, being out on the sharp end. It's a matter of judgment and experience, things we can't teach. We can, however, take a real close look at the techniques involved. The leader protects himself by placing equipment at strategic spots. Thus, he limits his fall to twice the distance above his highest placement. When and where to place protection is strictly the leader's prerogative. Person who seconds the rope, taking all the equipment out. There is no danger for this man or woman because the rope runs above him, generally the position I like to be in. You see that back there? That's over 75 miles away. 8,000 feet of vertical granite. They call it a big wall. Because it's a mighty big wall, so big, in fact, that no one man can climb it in one day. So any wall, so big, so grand, so colossal, that it cannot be climbed in one day, is a big wall. So is that. I'm going big wall climbing. See ya.
Your lady, your lady.
Free soloing, or climbing without a rope, graphically illustrates the fact that the risks are there if you want to take them. Over the last 8, maybe 10 years, free soloing has become increasingly popular, but bear in mind that chief practitioners are generally climbers with 8, even 10 years experience. But even for them, accidents do occur, and generally they're fatal. A belay is our chief line of defense in stopping a falling climber. It is a technique which must be executed with absolute certainty. Despite alternatives, the hip belay is the fundamental method of belaying. The rope is wrapped around the climber's hams, and with one hand, the left in this instance, serves as the brake hand. In the event of a fall, the brake hand comes across the body, and the combined friction is adequate to secure the rope. The popular and recent method is the Munter hitch, a hitch which locks upon itself in a fall. The device, rather than your back, absorbs much of the stress generated in the fall. To tie it, make a loop, cross it over the juncture, and clip the double section into the carabiner. The hitch slides both ways when feeding rope out and when taking rope in. In a fall, the brake hand simply comes off to the side, securing the hitch on the carabiner. Another popular device is the sticked plate, which works on the same principle as that other German apparatus. A bite comes up through the stick plate and clips into the carabiner. In the event of a fall, the rope is locked between the plate and the carabiner. Once again, in this instance, the left hand is a brake hand and it comes off to the side, securing the hitch. The last device is a figure eight descending ring, generally used for a rappel, though it works equally well as the belay device. The belay can vary from a stately ledge to a hanging stance. Communication between the climbers is very important. Even before the climber steps off the ground, certain signals must be exchanged.
On belay?
Belay's on.
Climbing.
Climb.
As the ascent proceeds, other signals must be used.
A top rope.
In other words, take up the slack. But not so much where she's held on tension. That's not free climbing.
Slack!
If she comes onto tension or has to move down, you'll have to feed a little bit of rope out. Anything else, climbing is a game of techniques. Crack climbing techniques, face climbing techniques, all kinds of techniques. Bear in mind, just like any other sport, it takes years to master all of these techniques. Finesse, fitness, all kinds of things come into play. Let's take a look at the fundamentals. With open face climbing, where you're principally interested in hand and foothold, maintaining correct body position is half the battle. Note how the climber does not hug the rock, but remains vertical, with his weight directly over his feet. There are as many different kinds of holds as there are ways of grabbing them. Edges, where the fingers crimp down directly upon a sharp edge. Rounded holds, where the friction of the fingertips is the key. And side pulls. The combination, the variety, it's infinite. Another standard move is a mantle shelf, or how you surmount a big hole. Here it's done with relative ease. In its extreme form, on overhanging rock, a mantle can be nasty indeed. With face climbing, footwork is the single most important element. The most basic move is the friction step. Another basic move is the smear, where the boot is smeared upon a sloping hole. Is a hold much better defined. Again, body position is a key. Always keep the weight directly over the feet. Crack climbing, then, is a different animal altogether. Note the variety of different jamming techniques. Lie-backing, perhaps the most strenuous technique. Finger jamming, painful indeed. Hand jamming, far and away the most secure. Foot jamming. Offsides, a dreaded technique, where the crack becomes too wide to jam an appendage. And chimney. Stemming, perhaps the most elegant of all climbing techniques. Once we get
up here, we've got to get down. The method we use is called rappelling. Far and away, the most dangerous practice in all of rock climbing. The reason is, we have to put complete trust in our equipment and our anchor. Basically, there are two ways to get down. One employs a figure of eight, and the other employs carabiners. The carabiner break first involves clipping two carabiners through the harness or the swami and leg loops. Notice how the gates are opposed. Two additional carabiners are clipped onto these two, also with the gates opposed. A bite of rope is then brought up through the second group of carabiners. And one, two, possibly even three carabiners are fitted between with the gates down. This way, the top of the carabiner acts as a brake system, which the rope runs over. One last check, then it's over the lip. The figure of eight first involves a locking carabiner, which is fitted through the swami and the leg loops or the harness. A bite of rope is slipped up through the big hole in the figure eight, then slid around the small hole, which in turn clips in to the locking carabiner. This device provides adequate friction for a safe rappel. With any rappel device, the brake hand, in this instance the right hand, regulates the speed of descent. When it goes slower, just wrap that rope around the hip. An emergency method is the dolpher sits, or body rappel. And you better be well clothed if you want to use this one. Body position is very important. The rappeller will always want to keep the upper body perpendicular to the cliff and always maintain a smooth and steady rate of descent. The knot used to tie two ropes together is a grapevine knot. I defy someone to be able to describe this in words. Best to just watch this example and practice on your own. No need to wear out that rewind button. Here it is up close. The most common method of retrieving the rope is to double the rope through the anchor. Once a climber reaches the ground, he is free to pull one end of the rope, thus retrieving both. But better watch it when that rope comes down.
Rope!
With that then, we've covered all the fundamentals to modern rock climbing. Let's move on to an actual climb and see if we can't put the whole process together.
rope stretched to the top of a given climb. The consequence, then, is multi-pitch or multi-rope length climbing. The lead is usually leapfrogged. He who follows the first pitch inherits the lead on the second. Never any doubt whether that rope's going to reach the ground, tie yourself a big girthy knot in the end just to make sure you don't rappel clean off the line. Does it for us. I hope you had a good time. Like we said at the outset, we can never hope to replace actual hands-on instruction, but hopefully we brought it into focus all the fundamentals basic to the safe and enjoyable experience we all want. The rest is up to you. Happy climbing. I'm John Long, and welcome to The Art of Leading. This video is designed for the climber who is familiar with the fundamentals of rope management, equipment, and technique, and who is ready to start leading. We'll focus on the system necessary to execute multi-pitch climbs, what it takes to be both safe and efficient, an in-depth review of the equipment involved, and a close look at the techniques one will encounter on multi-pitch routes. Again, The Art of Leading is based on the Yosemite system, which stresses safety and simplicity. No one can learn to lead by watching a video, but if you can master the material we'll be covering, you'll start off in the right boot. Let's take it from the top.
Freedom, and the exuberance one gets from moving over difficult rock. These are all amplified many-fold when you step out on the lead. As a leader, you affirm what's sacred to every adventure, because now you're playing for keeps. And all the decisions, when to slot a nut or when to just go for it, is your call. You're the boss, and such freedom can be both exciting and truly rewarding. Can likewise be terrifying, even dangerous, should you be deficient in any of the fundamentals. It might forever be a mystery how a climber of Ron Couch or Mari Gingrey's prowess can make the nastiest climb look easy. But it's no mystery on how they manage to make that climb safe. It boils down to sound execution of the fundamentals. Fundamentals which, with practice, most anyone can master. Experience exciting and novel things, to perhaps learn something about ourselves, and ultimately, to have fun.
You're a first-time leader, and wisely, you've chosen a route well within your abilities. Now, before you can rope up, you've got to get there. That's where a guidebook comes into play.
Ideally, the guide clearly states where the route begins, where the difficulties lie, an accurate rating of those difficulties, and the requisite gear for a safe and sane ascent.
But just because the given route's in print, that by no means assures one the information is exactly right.
Dwindling greenbacks, 512E. Yeah, sometimes those topples are a little thin.
And when the guidebook says just head for the obvious hand crack, well, the hardest part might just be finding the cliff. Sure, of course I'm sure. It says so right here. Follow the stream bed to Little Cheops, and hang a sharp right over narrowing terrain.
She's narrow.
And sometimes it's your own friends who suggest something less than the best advice.
This ain't it. Dead end, babe. No way, babe. We're not backtracking 12 miles. There it is right there. You can fit through there.
Say where?
Yeah, right there, babe. If you can fit through there, I can.
No way. You couldn't get a pool cue through here.
I don't think it's gonna work.
It's gonna work there in hell. Ah!
Hey, I think I'm getting stuck. I know I'm stuck.
Easy, babe. I'll get you out of there.
Ah! Ah! Not so hard.
Just relax just for a bit, babe. I got just the thing to get you out of there. Okay, babe. Just relax. Just relax.
What the hell's that? No. No.
If something seems wrong, it probably is. Just use your common sense.
You need to bring more to the cliff than just the gear. A great climb starts with a realistic goal and a positive attitude.
Oftentimes, the most perilous part of a climb is simply getting started. For if you fall, you hit the ground. A good move is to climb no higher than where you feel comfortable jumping off. Once there, set a good nut. That should free your mind to enjoy what you're there for, the climbing.
Off-width, also known as off-size, is called so because no part of your body fits the crack just right. Consequently, we're left to use ingenious stacking, levering, and counter-pressure techniques. The idea is to alternatively lodge the feet and the upper body. When the feet are secure, we creep the torso up for another purchase. Foot stacking and the standard heel and toe jam are two useful techniques. The upper body is generally secure with several variations of the basic arm bar, which uses opposing leverage, the back of the elbow and the palm of the hand. The hand which is not busy armbarring is generally clasping the lip of the crack, providing additional leverage. If there's one thing to keep in mind, it's to climb slowly and never resign yourself to thrashing.
Like any other sport, the right strategy is half the battle. Since no two climbs are precisely alike, there are few hard and fast rules a leader can apply. There are, however, several standard tricks which all good leaders employ.
Like a chess master, the leader must read the rock, plan his moves as far in advance as possible, pick the right sequence, and execute it fluidly. And when you're heading for a crack section, that's when you want additional protection, regardless of all the other nuts you might have in below you. The trick here is to stop on a foothold or in the least strenuous spot. All this requires a leader to be alert, looking ahead, planning the sequence, recognizing the difficulties before they're on them. Now, in some cases, you're going to be hanging on for keeps, trying to get that nut in. In others, like here, there's no protection whatsoever, save for that. So if you want to make the climb, you're just going to have to go for it.
Of course, unprotected climbing is a calculated risk requiring both courage and a dash of madness. As a beginning leader, if you have any doubts about making a given section and the fall looks dangerous, it's best to back off and return later when you well know your capabilities.
Ultimately, it boils down to one's judgment. How accurate is your strategy? How you read the rock? How you plot your moves relative to the available protection? And when the protection is a little thin, how resolved are you to make that climb?
jamming. Though a rarely used technique, you're bound to run into it if you ever make it to Yosemite or the desert areas. As with all climbing, it's your feet rather than your arms that should take the bulk of your weight. Fist quacks readily accept your feet, but pick your spot carefully. Look for constrictions and torque each foot until it feels solid. And whatever size the crack, the first order of business is to protect it. Then you take a shot at the climbing. A video is incapable of showing you just how to place nuts, but what with all the new camming devices, a fist crack is amongst the most easily protected. The crack is wide and often uniform, perfect for those cams. All jamming entails placing a hand inside the crack, then expanding the hand. Because the fist can be expanded very little, it's important to work for the best jam, finding that place where the fist fits tight to begin with, then expanding it to make the jam solid. Remember, it's easy to let the fist rotate in a crack, which can result in some very painful abrasions.
So, Doc, what are we looking at here?
Far logger, man. We got the call about an hour ago in the meat wagon. By the time we got there, there wasn't much we could do. This chump was booking it up a fist crack, splashing like a mackerel out of water. By the time we got there, his hands were gone.
Gone?
Gone.
You have to watch how you set those jams. A hand crack is the Cadillac of all crack climbing. The technique is quickly learned, and a good hand jam secures the most bulbous bucket. Again, the experienced climber will pick and choose his jams carefully, finding that spot where the hand fits most naturally. Because hand cracks are relatively secure, it's often easy to stop and place protection. Above all, try and stop in the least strenuous spot, and avoid plugging up the best hand jam with your protection. Also, when moving past your protection, make certain you don't entangle your foot in the nut. The inverted hand jam, where the thumb is down, is a good way to get added torque for tight jams. Just the same, the thumb up position remains the standard technique. Parallel-sided crack, a climber rarely places the self-same jam one after the other. But whatever the sequence, the thumb is always working overtime. The feet must be jammed themselves. Twist the ankle, slide in the toe, then twist it back towards the horizontal to lock it down. Climb smoothly and efficiently, using just enough strength to remain secure, but no more.
A good hand crack will literally swallow a climber's hand. And like fist jamming, hand jamming can result in unsightly wounds, even if your technique is perfect. A popular practice is to tape up.
No matter how you wrap it, it's the back of the hand that you're trying to protect. And don't wrap it too tight. You'll cut off the circulation and make it that much harder to flex, which greatly reduces a jam's effectiveness. And don't over-tape. Come on. And don't forget, used tape is nothing less than trash.
that stuff lying around. That's bad form.
Now, buddy, let's see you eat that dog. The 1970s can well be called the decade of thin cracks. The bulk of the most difficult raps of that decade were thin. Protecting a thin crack is often the most difficult task, and surely the most important, since thin cracks are usually very insecure. Both the actual climbing and the act of protecting that climbing requires the leader to be extremely aware of the smallest nuances of the crack. It's often a matter of millimeters, and finding the correct sequence of finger jams is essential. To spot the best place for the protection, and a lot of experience to get exactly the right nut off the rack. Remember this. Make sure your hands and feet are set before you try and stop to protect. You must feel the cracks of the best jams, because no matter how strong those guns are, they'll soon burn out if your footwork is not precise. The thinner the crack, the more necessary it is to get your weight over your feet. And because the nut will sometimes take the best slot for the fingers, the leader will often place the nut below his hands, at head level. Security of a crack out onto the open face, he's leaving behind the ready opportunities to protect himself. That's why a leader will sometimes opt to stack the protection, placing two, three, or however many nuts he feels is necessary to secure the climbing overhead. He'll often use quick draws to reduce the possibility of rope drag. A quick draw is a short piece of webbing, either sewn or tied, which serves as a short runner or sling. When you're clawing up some bald face, the last thing you want is the rope holding you back.
Slack!
You got it!
I said slack, you knucklehead!
The name's Mac. The pot licker. Dumbo couldn't pull that rope now. All he needed was a couple of these.
Slack!
American climbs tend to follow straight lines, but not always. A European technique of belaying on two 9mm ropes instead of a single 11 has several advantages when routes tend to wander. The double rope comes into its own when the available protection is all over the place. Whereas, even with 100 runners, a single lead rope would cause desperate rope drag. The double rope is handy indeed for the second who has to traverse between protection points.
Hey, Jack!
It's Mac!
Black!
On the black?
The black's on the crack!
Check the rack!
Black!
It can get confusing. Best to try it on an easy climb first. Many climbers prefer the security of a good crack, but just as many can't wait to enjoy the sweet science of face climbing. While the steeper face climbs require fearsome strength, with precision, grace, balance, and mental control, we generally equate with face climbing.
Few things look more daunting and involved than a climber scaling a bald face. In reality, face climbing is the most natural form of climbing. And with a little practice, all the complicated looking moves will come as natural as your next breath.
Let's watch a master at work. How pumped you are, if the protection is good and you're a gamer, you'll go for it.
Anyone who works with precision, a surgeon, a diamond cutter, a pool hustler, the good ones all know one thing, how to relax. So there's nothing more important to the face climber and relaxing.
The tense climber overgrips and his fingers tire quickly. His legs tremble when they aren't tired.
And worse still, he gets tunnel vision. He either won't or can't see beyond his hands. And you'll never get the right sequence if you're not looking ahead, and you can't look ahead unless you're relaxed. First comes body position. Ideally, your torso should always be vertical. This way, gravity puts your weight directly over your feet, and it's your feet you want to climb on.
Of course, on the really bleak slate, it boils down to raw power. Once you get to this level, you won't be needing this video.
As mentioned, you want to keep that weight on your feet to save arm strength, which goes quickly. Now, it's a pretty helpless task trying to teach you face climbing while you're sitting on that divan, but there are some basics that you should be aware of. First, face climbing is a matter of millimeters. The holes are often puny at best, so you've got to be very precise with placing your feet.
Which is impossible if you're not relaxed. You'll be wobbling and then fretting, and you'll just kick your foot towards the hold.
No. You pick the hold, and you carefully place your boot on it.
Likewise, when you go to step on the hold, don't jump on it. That's the best way for that foot to come skating off. Rather, transfer your weight very gingerly, trying to keep the boot from moving on the hold. And whether you're edging or smearing, you'll generally do so on the inside part of the big toe. That's where both strength and feeling are located. However, a climber who knows how to use the outside edge of his boot enjoys a big advantage. The outside edge can stick to the merest nothing, and with little strength, since the bones rather than the muscles of the foot absorb the weight.
Now for the hands. Ideally, we'd all be Martians with those big suckers on our hands, but we're not. So to overcome the problems of sweat and grip, most climbers opt to use gymnastic chalk.
Gymnastic chalk is very useful when the temperature brings on sweaty hands. The drawbacks are that chalk is unsightly, and it tends to map out the sequence for future parties. For better or for worse, chalk has become an accepted evil in modern climbing.
There are as many ways to clasp holds as there are different kinds of holds, but there seem to be three basic positions.
The hook hold, where one pulls straight down on the fingers. This posture is only used on very minuscule holds, can be fearsomely painful, and neglects your strongest digit, your thumb. But it's useful all the same. The standard crank position is when the finger pads are laid over the hold and the last two joints are bent at a 45-degree angle relative to the hold. The thumb is then wrapped over the index finger and you're set to pull the walls down. On severely rounded holds, you want to get as much of the finger pad on the hold as possible. And the claw hold works best here. Since you don't enjoy the stability of locked joints with the claw hold, the forearms take all the load. So the claw hold is usually the most strenuous way to clasp a hold. Another useful and sometimes essential technique is mantling. It comes into play when you gain a hold, usually but not always big, which you must first mount, then step directly upon. In its simplest form, you place your hands on the hold. Cock the elbow, press it out, and step on up. Mantling takes practice, but no matter how proficient you get, remember this. A difficult mantle is hard to reverse, and once you're committed, there's no changing your mind. A mantle puts one in an awkward position, and if there is no hold or reach once the mantle is pressed out, you're liable to find yourself in a piece of trouble. So if you have to mantle, look for a hold to go for once the mantle is started, and be aggressive about pushing it out.
As a leader, you've got to keep in mind all of these techniques and worry about protecting yourself. Now, it's totally unrealistic for me to try and describe how to protect a face climb, but there's several rules of thumb worth mentioning. First, never pass up an obvious place to throw a nut in. And second, whenever you come across fixed protection, a bolt, a nut, a piton, never automatically assume it's bombproof. Check it carefully and always back it up if possible. So what do we have? We have you relaxed as a Zen monk with the bulk of your weight over the smooth-soled shoes. You're moving fluidly from one hold to the next, throwing in nuts like there's no tomorrow. All the while, you're looking ahead, planning the best sequence, climbing with control and deliberation towards the next protection.
Then you hit the steep stuff, and it's a different game altogether. You're entering the realm of power climbing.
The free climbing revolution of the early 70s was concerned with free climbing the big walls and refining the art of thin crack climbing. In the 80s, the paradigm shifted to the overhanging and bereft faces, and the art of power face climbing came into its own. And the best way to learn power climbing is to go bouldering. While the technique and power accrued from bouldering directly applies to rope climbing, Most find bouldering so much darn fun, they consider it a sport unto itself. No better way to refine your technique than bouldering, where one can try the impossible and where the only consequence of failure is to dust yourself off and try again. Should the landing be bad or the problem too high, either use a spotter or rig a top rope. Remember, of course, that whenever you fall off, you hit the ground. The common form of climbing injuries occur from people toppling off boulders and twisting or breaking ankles. There is nothing more important to safe climbing than a bomb-proof belay. Without it, you have nothing, and a courting disaster. With it, you have a controlled situation where there is no reason anyone should get hurt. On multi-pitch climbs, the belay must be rigged in virtually countless different ways, but there are several basic principles which any belay should adhere to. Save for a ponderosa pine, never belay from a single piece of protection. The most common belays are rigged in vertical cracks, and don't forget this, always place a nut for the upward pull. When rigging a belay in a horizontal crack, equalize the anchor whenever possible. An accepted method is just this. In general, a three-piece anchor is the minimum acceptable as bomb-proof. If there's any doubt, place another nut and another until there's no doubt whatsoever. Always tie in with two carabiners and always oppose the gates. Sometimes, equalizing the anchor is a tricky piece of work. The clove hitch is a handy knot here, for it's more easily adjusted. With hanging belays, it's best to belay through the anchor, so the system, rather than your body, takes the weight of a potential fall. Pitch, it is their job to remove all the protection and to re-rack it in a neat and orderly fashion. Racking is a matter of personal choice, but generally, carabiners come first, followed by nuts of increasing sizes. For the carabiners harboring those nuts, always rack them gate out for easy access. In the last few years, there's been an explosion of new high-tech crack gadgets, many of which have rendered traditional modes of protection almost obsolete. Even a professional climber finds he must stay up on the literature to keep abreast of the new gear, and always take the opportunity to tinker with a new piece of gear a friend or an acquaintance might have. A good belay requires assiduous attention to the rope, and sometimes when the going is slow, a belayer's mind can wander extravagantly.
Watch me.
I've been watching you for 45 minutes. You haven't even budged.
Just watch me. Close.
Yeah.
Hey, dog in guard. Not too long. Big around. Just watch that belay. Close. As mentioned, most climbs follow straight lines. However, when a route traverses, it is the leader's responsibility to place enough protection so the second doesn't die should he fall during the traverse. In this instance, the leader hasn't placed anything. For the poor sap that has to follow this pitch, should he fall, he'll be in for a big time swing. Here, the leader has been more conscientious, placing a nut directly off the belay. Much safer for the man that follows. Once the second has reached the belay, the first order of business is to tie themselves off to the anchor. Then the belayer takes the belay off. You study the climbing overhead. Get your partner's opinion and construct a rack which you feel is appropriate for the next pitch. Your rack should ideally consist of everything you'll need to secure atomic protection, and not one piece more. Who wants to lug stuff you'll never use? The gear nut, that's who. He's got gear enough to solo mount Thor, which is the last thing he'll ever do, since that would involve using and possibly scratching some of that gear.
Okay, you got me on?
Yeah, you're on.
Switching leads is a simple and safe procedure, providing you do this. Make certain you are on belay before you unclip from the anchor. Once unclipped, immediately clip your rope through the anchor, so should you fall, the anchor, rather than your partner's body, will absorb at least the bulk of your weight. Of course, a belay is not what it should be if it can't withstand the longest possible fall. But you'll never want to fall directly on the belay because of the real possibility of falling on your belayer. So once you leave the belay, try and get a good nut in as quickly as possible. Also be aware that falls with only 8 to 10 feet of rope out are the hardest on the rope. Owing to the dynamic properties of a furlon rope, the more rope you have out, the less the shock, since there is more rope to absorb the fall. Backing is possibly the most strenuous and thrilling technique in all of climbing.
It's also the quickest way to find hell in a handbasket. Owing to great opposing pressures, should you fall, you'll fire off like you're spring-loaded. Liebacking has been called the technique of no technique, but that's hardly the case.
Liebacking is self-explanatory, but heed the following points. Many hard liebacks are exercises in trying not to hinge off. Though more strenuous, it's often better to keep your feet high, increasing the opposing pressure between hands and feet. On a straight-on or flake lieback, scour the face for footholds. It's on a foothold where you'll want to stop and place protection. There's nothing like swinging into a bold lieback. You can span amazing rock, and it's thrilling to feel your own power. But don't forget, the grim labaks put you in a volatile position. So much so, there's a special place for the few who cast off without setting that bomb-proof nut.
They didn't bother with the nuts.
Chimning is most often considered a dreadful technique. Far from elegant, and often little more than a grunt. But with a little practice, even chimning can be fun.
Occasionally, you're going to run into a chimney system that is so shallow, you can't get in the back. These are called flares, and unless properly done, are one of the worst climbing experiences that you can run into. The trick is to decide which way you're going to face when you're in these. And usually the decision is based upon what side of the wall has the best footholds. Now, just like in chimneying, the basic position is to have the back against one wall and the feet on the other. As you proceed up, the thing to remember is always move very securely, very slowly, and make sure the feet and the hands are placed exactly where you want them. Climb very smoothly and slowly. Now, as soon as you get up to where the flare pinches down, and you have to climb on the outside of it, the normal technique is to use an arm bar, which is a combination of pressure on the back of the elbow and the palm here placed as such. So again, when you're doing these moves, the first and foremost thing to remember is don't thrash. Try to be as secure and solid with each foot placement and the placement of the arms as you possibly can. Lift feet again. Place the arm bar.
A route of any length is bound to have some bad rock, a hold, a flake, even a whole pitch. Tread gently on any suspect rock. Test the holds, but always bear in mind that anything you pull off could hit both the rope and your belayer. Warn your belayer when you encounter any suspect rock, and whenever dislodging anything, make sure to yell,
"Rock!"
Though rare in popular climbing areas, rockfall is not unheard of, and the consequences are usually serious. Completing your climb, executing your plan to the letter, safely, meeting a stiff challenge, and walking away with a feeling of being 200% alive. That's where it's at for a leader. That's when you know why they call rock climbing the world's greatest sport.
Most veterans admit the real fun doesn't begin until you jump out on the sharp end, on the lead. It takes a natural athlete and bulldog determination to become a world-class leader. But most anyone with knowledge and desire can experience the freedom, the thrill, and the feeling of command that comes with leading a challenging pitch. Leading is as safe or as dangerous as you choose to make it. And if we've said anything in this video, it's that the safe leader is sound in his fundamentals. He's quick to place a nut. His belays are rock solid, and his moves are deliberate and calculated. From here on, it's your call. And have the time of your life. Happy climbing.
possibility just 5 years ago. That was before the Masters of Stone.
Far from the maddening crowd toils an amazingly skilled and powerful breed of stuntmaster. You probably have never seen them because they work in a world beyond your reach. They hold the balance of their lives in the tips of their fingers. This is the state of the art of the clinging, grasping, lunging, and plunging world of rock climbing. These are the Masters of Stone.
Like a choreographed dance, a precision movement, because you can't be scraping your feet around. It has to be precisely placed on the knob, and you equalize your weight. It's a balancing act to put how much weight can you put in your fingers and your left foot and move up the rock.
This is a sport which has no place for hot dogs and daredevils. A daily regimen of torturous strengthening exercises can make the difference between an exhilarating first ascent and a fatal plunge. Considering its difficulty, very few climbers among the top ranks are seriously injured, much like stuntmen. It's the underprepared amateurs whose frequent injuries constantly remind us just how dangerous these climbs are.
You know, it's like if you see a guy at the circus swallowing a sword, or some dude laying on a bed of nails or something, you're not going to go home and try to lay on a bed of nails. You know, it's just common sense. And people who don't have that amount of common sense and go up and try to solo something and fool themselves into thinking they're in control, they're going to get hurt, you know. I guess it's like survival of the species, you know. Dumb ones die.
High-level climbing falls into several classifications. The most popular is free climbing, which involves using a rope as a safety line. But free soloing involves no hardware at all. Just a climber's hands, feet, unyielding determination, and unshakable nerve. Even though free soloing is exponentially more dangerous than all other forms of rock climbing, for some, it is the only way to achieve the ultimate adrenaline rush.
Free soloing is the ultimate form of free climbing. You eliminate the rope. You're up there like a bird or a lizard. It's about as free as you can be.
While all of what these two dozen top climbers do seems equally impossible to us mere mortals, within this elite group, each has his own version of the perfect climb.
At the Wild Iris, the only thing I'm interested in is bouldery, powerful moves. The roots are short and savage. And to me, that's the only thing that gathers my interest and holds it. It's something that's right at the edge of the strength of my tendons.
For some, just being able to climb at all is enough of a thrill. Mark Wellman nearly lost his life in a climbing accident. But those who thought he would never climb again knew little of this man's determination and desire. But like every adventure sport, there are those who take a radical departure from the mainstream. In this case, that honor goes to the Rock Warriors, an aggressive group of hardcore climbers who get together from time to time for a primal game of King of the Mountain. Top climbers Dan Osmond and Dave Griffith spawned this spin-off. And despite some of the aggressive antics and dangerous moves, these guys are all friends and no one gets hurt. To these climbers, traditional climbing contests do not satisfy their quest for the competitive climbing duel. To them, trophies do not hold the value of that elusive prize which awaits them at the end of each challenging climb. But all climbers have one thing in common. They all want that adrenaline rush which greets them at the top of any mountain. And while some use a rope, some only their limbs, and some sheer determination, there is no denying that these are some of the world's most impressive stuntmasters.
In just a few moments, a red-hot ride is at a world record.
Every climber steps into the ring with two opponents, gravity and his own limitations. This is the story of some of the best climbers in America on some of the toughest routes. Climbing's a game, and everyone plays by a different set of rules. Some take it easy, and some take it hard, but everyone plays to win. Nobody sane becomes a climber. Climbing is sore fingers, shredded hands, and the mental pain of failing again and again until you succeed or walk away in disgust. Climbing is about being too hot and too cold, being overtrained, underfed, and underpaid. Climbing is also about freedom and the joy of pushing the outer limits. It's about reaching for levels of power and mastery that always lie just a hair beyond our grasp. These are the masters of stone. We'll let them tell their own story.
Mm-hmm. Any resistance in this chord of music. It almost feels like I'm lubricating all my joints. For me, climbing in Tuolumne on routes like Electric Africa or Clash of the Titans is like a choreographed dance of precision movement, because you can't be scraping your feet around. It has to be precisely placed on the knob, and you equalize your weight. It's a balancing act to put how much weight can you put on your fingers and your left foot and move up the rock as effortless as you can and feeling as light as possible on the tiny little knobs. I think what you're doing in bouldering, like here in Tuolumne, is you're working with explosive moves, just total power. And it's always a crux move, crux move, crux move. So when you get on a route, you can see through it really quick.
Endurance more so than cruxes, and the sissy traverse just enhances that. It's a long endurance problem that just works you, and with a little bit of a crux at the end, but mostly it's just hanging on and going for the ride. I try never to climb more than 2 days in a row. If I'm on a road trip, I like the schedule 2 days on, 1 day off, 2 days on, 2 days off. And that seems to let me recover and really be efficient, so I'm not just out there floundering around and going through the motions so much, but I'm actually climbing, I'm getting things done, redporting routes, flashing routes, and that seems to work really well for me. What makes the Slayer so awesome is that it maintains about a 135 to 140 degree angle. Moves are really hard. I mean, right off the start, you got a rude awakening. This thing's like a giant belly of a whale, and you're just hugging it, slapping it the whole way. Holds aren't much better either. Thank you.
So you've really got to maintain good footwork, real positive. You got to keep the opposition going, and which is real hard to do because you constantly want to keep making these reaches and everything's underneath you and your feet are hard to see, your footholds are hard to see. So to keep the flow going in your moves, you've constantly got to be looking for these toe hooks, heel hooks, back steps. Body English is extremely vital. And just turning your hips from one side to the other just makes all the difference in the world. Because the holds, they're not always facing down. I mean, they may be sideways or under clings, and you've got to just adjust to make that work. Maintain the power, but yet not overpower, because you need to save it. It's like a tank full of gas. You've only got so much gas to get a certain distance. And if you accelerate too much, well, then you're going to use up too much gas. You're not going to have enough for the end. You've got to really adjust that. Let that flow of energy come out at an even rate. Can't get too excited. You've got to be psyched and real feel the power of the climb, but yet you've got to maintain it. Even balance in your adrenaline, because that'll scare you, your head will get elated, and you'll just pump off.
Sometimes when I've been trying a climb and there's a difficult crux section that I've had trouble with, I'll go home and with artificial hold duplicate the crux and work on it at home a little bit. Dynamic movement up to the lip of the overhang, and then you're so tired that I can't clip the bolt that's there, so what I have to do is skip it. So it's kind of scary for me. I get scared, and then I have to pull up and do another horizontal move and then another dead point, and you still haven't clipped a bolt yet. So why don't you do it?
looking for just power.
I've tried eating right, you know, I've tried following a health food diet for months or at least weeks at a time, and I don't feel any different, so I just decided I'd rather eat ice cream than broccoli.
Ago, about maybe 100 years ago, many Japanese have a Yamato Damashi. So Yamato Damashi means God. So don't be afraid for death or anything. Just go for it to your purpose. So that is a God. Sure, I have Yamato Damashi, but I can say I love climbing a lot. So climbing is kind of my lifestyle.
port.
When Mark Wellman was paralyzed by a climbing accident, everyone assumed he would spend the rest of his life on the flats. But this is a sport about toughing out the hard stuff. Wellman lost the use of his legs, but not his fighting spirit.
Nice about the valley, you look out and you just see the trees, you don't see all the buildings.
Rock's so solid here that you can just plug something in. It's not like sandstone and Canyonlands or something like that. You can rely on your gear here as long as you place it properly. And then you can go for these big runouts. And just, you know, like something on the Rostam roof here, if you fall off, it does not matter. You could take a 100-foot fall and it will not matter at all. All it will do is, you know, it'll scare you a bit.
Everybody laughing my face.
you can see people free soloing, and it looks easy, and they're flowing up the rock, and everything's, it doesn't look hard. But when you go up and try something that's a little bit over your head, you're gonna get scared real quick, and almost guaranteed you're gonna come down. You know, it's like you see a guy at the circus swallowing a sword, or some dude laying on a bed of nails or something. You're not gonna go home and try to lay on a bed of nails, you know, it's just common sense. And people who don't have that amount of common sense and go up and try to solo something and fool themselves into thinking they're in control, they're gonna get hurt, you know. I guess it's like survival of the species, you know. People, the dumb ones die. Free soloing is the ultimate form of free climbing. You eliminate the rope, you're up there like a bird or a lizard. It's about as free as you can be.
From when I started working on it and figured that I could definitely do it, it took me 12 days to do. About to do the crux lunge move, that took me 6 hours to figure out, just that one move. But then I got down to where I could hit that every time, and that wasn't the red point crux for me. When I train, I boulder until failure, or climb until failure. I want to, you know, ideally on a training day, my hands will be opening up at the end of the day on a huge bucket.
Yeah.
here's the instructional part of this video.
Okay.
This is pro. This is a rope. The rest is up to you.
Thing is, you can fall from right here and it ain't no big deal. See?
In the wild iris, the only thing I'm interested in is bouldery, powerful moves. The roots are short and savage. And to me, that's the only thing that gathers my interest and holds it. It's something that's right at the edge of the strength of my tendons. And then just maybe a little bit beyond, so I have to train and become powerful enough to do those moves. All of your concentration is laser point and very directed into one bit. So when you're at the base of a root, you haven't got the burden of this whole huge, complex series of moves. You simply have small bits that you can think about and can believe in. And if you can believe in each individual section, eventually you can believe in the root. We'll be right back.
Good Lord.
Rifle's so steep, it's fully raining right now, and this cave is perfectly dry. Daydream Nation, it's gotta be the wildest route I've ever seen. It's a 50-foot pitch, totally horizontal roof, with a little bulge at the top in this cave. There are 7 bolts. The first 35 feet is sustained inverted 12D, and then you hit a 20-foot bouldering section of just thin pockets, powerful dynos. You're toe hooking, you're doing everything you can. Keep your body up under this roof, because as soon as you cut loose, you're out of there. The holds are too small. So your feet are on or you're out of there.
To pump you up. Climb 513, no problem.
Thank you.
hardest move on Scarface is by the third bolt. It's kind of a long pull to a shallow one-finger pocket, and then there's another long pull off the pocket. So that's the most powerful section on the climb, but the real crux is just continuity hanging in there. Most people fail pulling under the slab right at the end. Competition climbing is great. I really like it. It's a totally different challenge than climbing on the cliff. And I like the aspect of it that whatever you do in competition is like what you did. There's no exaggerating or sort of boasting about what you've done. It's clear cut. But to me, the most important thing in climbing is just going out with your friends and, you know, cranking some hard routes.
Will you stay my friend? You ask if I love you.
Climbers are like gunfighters. There's always someone quicker on the draw. Whether you're a beginner struggling up a 5'6 slab or a master styling a 5'14, the whole point of this sport is to push your own outer limits.
Chalkstone.
Yeah, this chalkstone is just sitting here, man.
Not like a 3/8 inch bolt, though.
I think maybe we were closer to mountaineers in the old days. Maybe we just did things in multiple pitches and things, and they weren't very hard. We didn't have that good of shoes, maybe, and we just kind of clumped up them and didn't work out moves and holes as much. So the stuff now is more gymnastic.
I think the difference now is that there are so many other routes out there that have opened my eyes to what's possible.
The main difference is that now they do a lot of working out the holes rather than doing it first time. And also there's more bolting so that they can have protection close to them and work out much harder moves.
I think Pratt's Crack is a cool line, and I've done it before. I think there's a lot of junk in it. And I wouldn't do it again, not if I could help it.
That's pretty extreme. I mean, that's something that we never dreamed about in my day.
Hey, look at this.
Oh, no, no. This.
Oh.
Stick, Lynn. Come on, Lynn. Stay, girl.
When the first Moving Over Stone was filmed, I was at my limit on this par 13. Now I've been able to do some 513s on my first try. My own progress in climbing reflects the many changes that have evolved in the sport. In fact, climbing has changed so much that people now refer to this style as sport climbing. The modern sport climbs have completely diverged from their origins in mountaineering. The most challenging climbs tend to fall dramatically overhanging faces. They're protected by closely spaced bolts, allowing the climber to push themselves to the maximum. Here I am climbing a route that I've never done before. This is an on-site lead, the best possible style. However, if someone gives me any information about the route, it's called beta, and if I climb the route on my first try with beta, it's called a flash ascent. But given the chance to practice the moves, most climbers would be capable of doing climbs harder than their on-site ability. A route done in this style is called a red point ascent. The moves are worked out and memorized until you can complete the climb without a fall. It may take days or even months to complete a red point ascent. You must be willing to push yourself and take some falls.
When you're climbing well, you will still think that you're hanging onto the rock when you hit the end of the rope. You'll be trying that hard.
Falling is a necessary part of learning to climb hard routes. If you eliminate the fear of falling, your mind is free to concentrate on the challenges before you. Sport climbing has led to newly discovered climbing areas and a new breed of climber. In this video, we will visit a few of these areas and learn from observing the style and techniques of various climbers. Each climber constantly refines technique to climb more efficiently. Efficiency begins with movements that blend effort with relaxation. Try not to grip too tight. Stay relaxed. Plan out the moves. Look at the next section of the climb while resting and visualize movements that could be made. Combine the effort into as few moves as possible. Grab the hold so it sets you up for the next move. Bolts are often placed near large holds so you don't waste energy clipping the bolt. Try not to clip from a position that is too low. Find the preferred stance, then clip the bolt. Stay relaxed and try not to think about falling. Clip the bolt quickly by pressing the rope against the gate of the carabiner. A good place to rest may not always be obvious. Here I use my feet to take weight off my arms. You'd be amazed at the rest you can find. These are just a few of the techniques specific to modern sport climbs. Using these techniques can help you climb more efficiently and climb harder routes. But apart from actual experience on the rock, watching others climb is one of the best ways to learn new techniques. Okay, I got it. Thank you. So get out there, grab a partner, and have some fun. Because practice is essential. A few years ago, a homemade climbing wall was the best way to practice climbing off the rocks. Today, there are gyms totally devoted to teaching climbing technique, but they're not just for beginners. John Yablonski, one of the original Yosemite Stonemasters, pumps plastic to perfect his own technique and sharpen his strength. Braden Mayfield already understood the basics of climbing at 4 years old. Now at 9, Braden has improved because his favorite place to climb is indoors. Climbing is a highly specialized form of sport climbing. Here at the City Rock Gym is a controlled environment in which to hone your skills. Likewise, it's a great place for people to learn the basics of climbing, from slabs to overhangs. Indoor rock gyms make it easy for people to get good fast. It's an inspiring atmosphere for people to get together and share ideas about style and technique. It's not unusual to see Dad playing on the wall while Baby takes her first vertical steps. However, the techniques learned in the gym don't always translate to climbing on real rock. For that, people are urged to seek a qualified guide, like Peter Mayfield, Braden's dad. He owns City Rock Gym, and thanks to him, Braden may be one of the stone masters of the future. Artificial climbing walls are ideal for holding competitions, from the International World Cup level to informal gatherings among friends. Steve Schneider has officiated many unofficial events, including the Pretty in Pink Point competition, the Tuolumne Campground Classic, And now, Steve has been invited to set the course for the High Sierra Invitational.
Man, I don't see no climbing wall here.
Oh, it's the course setter. Hey, come on in, Steve.
Wow, this place is happening, Hermos. Killer. As chief course setter, I'll be designing an intricate pattern of holds set to keep the climber at his wit's end, so to speak. Here we go. Holds are dishwasher safe. Oh, yeah, we'll just go for the nice Guaco here and killer three-finger pocket. Oh, we'll build a beauty of a route. Killer jug. Oh, and the starfish. Oh, yeah, I love that guy. Okay, I always like to make the first moves pretty easy so that the climber doesn't fall off the ground and get really mad at you.
To get the most out of his small 16-foot wall, Steve has added a traverse. The holds are large in the beginning to warm the climber up.
Oh, yeah, that feels pretty good. And I want to make a nice little cutesy move here. They kind of have to undercling this a bit.
The next hold is placed lower than Steve's reach so that shorter people are not disadvantaged. Originally planned as an undercling, Steve has turned this hold into a side pull for a reach out left. The hold is tightened until snug. One of the most annoying problems is a spinning hold in a competition. Now Steve is set up for the crux, a reach for a bucket. This course served as a warm-up for a second course. Steve sets the second course over the warm-up route. The holds of each route are marked with colored dots.
Okay, we're about to bring our climbers out of sensory deprivation where they've been locked up for 3 days. That's so that when they come up, they have no prior knowledge of the route, and it is a vu ascent. Okay, you guys still alive in there?
Yeah,
ready
I
to
think
climb?
So.
Okay,
oh, yeah.
Can you see there?
Uh-uh.
Same thing's out of bounds. Blue dots only. Okay, good luck, Bozo. Looking good. Getting close. Getting the final move. Oh, almost. You've got 45 seconds to tie in and do the route.
And do the route.
Okay, but first we'll check your knot. Okay, it's good. Entering the crux sequence. Right near the top. Come on, Lionel, you can do it. You can do it. Come on, baby, go, baby. Send it. Yes! All right, Lionel, way to go! He flashes and wins the Super Duper competition. Here at the High Sierra World Cup Invitational, the competition's been hot and fierce, rad and bad. But we have our first place competitor. Good job today, Lionel Clay of New Zealand. We have a little gift certificate from you, $25 from Black Diamond. Congratulations.
All right.
And a copy of the video, Moving Over Stone 2, which you'll be in, Bubba. And our second place contender, Hermos Ranos from Mammoth Lakes. Good job yourself today. You almost stuck that final bucket. We got a little prize for you. Someone sort of drank it, but that's what you get. There you have it, folks, from Mammoth Lakes, California. Yosha Poopy.
Mount Lemmon in southern Arizona is where American climbing team member Bobby Bensman learned how to climb. Here she is climbing a 512 on site. When we first filmed her at Smith Rocks, she was at her limit on 512. These days, Bobby is red pointing 513s. Using sport climbing techniques, Bobby has advanced through higher levels of difficulty. Let's take a look at some of her favorite climbs at various levels of difficulty.
Mount Lemmon was great because we seemed to have a lot of different levels up there, lots of 5.4s up to 5.11s 10 years ago anyway, and it was a great place to just start learning how to lead and going through all the numbers. There were plenty of 5.6s, plenty of 5.7s, 5.8s, all the way up the range, so we just picked a number and we went through them. the flake route on Hitchcock, which is, it's a just a beautiful route, and it has those classic windy point edges in face climbing moves. And it's really neat because you kind of do a little laybacking, a little stemming, a little rocking over on high steps, and then you just reach the top, and it's a really nice view even from the top, even though the thing's about 40 feet, 50 feet high. But it's a really fun one for anybody that's beginner or advanced. I thought that Trouble in Paradise was just absolutely beautiful. I love to climb on arêtes, and this one in particular was just so pretty, going up this green and yellow lichen. And it was actually kind of a long route, and a newer route for people that climb 5.7, 5.8. It's bolted, and it's great to have bolt routes for people that climb at that level as well. And actually, if you feel comfortable, you can run it out to the next bolt. And if you don't feel comfortable, there's some really good nuts in between the a couple bolts down low. And it takes you also to the top of one of the spires at Windy Point. And it's a really nice place to be. The Rupley route, R4, is just such a neat route. It's really diverse. You have a little 5/10 start on the bottom if you want, or you can do a traverse into it. And that route has a bolt, couple bolts, one at the beginning and one at the end, and it has a lot of natural protection in between the two. And the thing that I really liked about that route is it was so varied. You do face climbing on it, you have a really dicey traverse, you have a hand crouch right out of roof. Embarrassingly enough, that was the first time I've placed protection in an awful long time. And I think I was overprotecting it. I think the person that came up second had a heck of a time taking them out. I did Lizard Marmalade Direct on site, let's see, I don't know, 7 years ago or something? A long time ago. But it is the most beautiful route on Mount Lemmon out of anything, and it's excellent. It's something I always, whenever I think of one of my favorite, most wonderful experiences, it's that route. And it's perfect. It's an endurance route. It's unrelenting. It never stops. It just keeps going, and it's long. And I just remember being so psyched when I did it. It was hard, and the gear was hard, and I was just pumped out of my mind on it. To this day, whenever I see people on it, I always tell them that's the best route on Mount Lemmon, although there's bolted routes everywhere right near it, around it, on top of it, but it's bomber gear. You can sew the thing up and you wouldn't even have to fall more than 2 feet on it. Hunchback Arete is beautiful. You don't realize how much you climb on the left side of it. When you first look at it, you think, oh, I'll be on the right side of it. But you're so much on both sides. It's real pretty. It's real delicate. And you get to do neat dancing moves on it, high steps and laybacks. It's real pretty. I love to climb now because of the new sport routes. They're set up in such a way that you can really push yourself.
Smith Rocks, Oregon, the birthplace of the American sport climbing revolution. When the first Moving Over Stone was filmed, Germany's Stefan Glowach was working out the moves on the hardest climb in America. This route, done by a visiting Frenchman, represented a landmark in American climbing. Today, the widespread use of bolts and siege tactics have been accepted in putting up America's most difficult routes. Now, another Frenchman has come to Smith to attempt what may be the hardest route in America. One of the most spectacular formations at Smith Rocks is the Monkey's Face. For years, the most common way to the summit was with a Tyrolean traverse. These days, most sport climbers don't even go to the summit. The prize on the monkey is the center of the east face. This route has been tried by many of the best climbers in the world and remains unclimbed. Now, one of Europe's best climbers, Didier Rabatou, will attempt this route on the east face of the monkey face. Let's take a look at some of the techniques Didier uses to climb this route. To reach higher holds, you may have to do a high step. Try to balance directly over your foot to stand high and maximize your reach. Now Didier will perform a type of dynamic move. He catches the hold at the dead point, the precise moment when his body is neither going up or falling down. Notice how smoothly Didier sets up his body position for the cliff. Also at Smith Rocks was Robin Urbisfield on the hardest route she's ever climbed. Her movements are precise and efficient.
Oftentimes I climb on a route that's harder than my ability, and it's not necessarily to redpoint the route, but to learn from the route, to find what I can do with movements that are beyond my immediate ability. I definitely believe that when you begin climbing, you should begin at a moderate level. Number one, to have fun, and to prevent injury. And to me, climbing is fun. And that's the number one thing, is to have fun. And I can climb routes that are very hard because I'm having fun. And my best on-sites and my best worked routes were simply because I had fun and I loved the route. And if it weren't for that, I couldn't do it.
Unfortunately, Didier sprained his ankle and was unable to climb the east face of the monkey. Who knows? Maybe an American will be the first to climb this route. Rock is ideal for sport climbing. Climbing a cliff like this can be a real adventure. For years, these cliffs were ascended in the boldest style, from the ground up, with minimal protection, on soft rock where a fall could be serious. Randy Grandstaff and Mike Tupper climbed many first ascents in the Red Rocks in this traditional style. But when the sport climbing trend spread across America, Mike Tupper began to realize the area's vast potential and bolted some of the most difficult routes in the Red Rocks. Randy places more emphasis on the style of ascent rather than difficulty. He will put up a first ascent in the traditional style, using the natural features for protection. Mike's first ascent will be a sport route. He will establish it from the top down, first figuring out the moves, then placing bolts on rappel.
On these short, 40 to 160 foot routes, especially when it's simple to walk to the back, I don't see any reason to go out there and get hurt, We've all pulled things off and chipped our teeth and cut our heads open and stuff, and there's no reason for that, not with the modern techniques we have. I'm gonna put up a first ascent, set up a top rope on it, and first thing to do is figure out where I want the route to end, figure out where to put the chains. Put in the chains, then I'll rappel down it and kick it if it's steep enough or not so steep. So as long as I can touch the wall, I'll continue to kick it on the way down and knock off as much of the loose flakes as I can. And then I'll work the route if it's hard, I'll work it several times to figure out where the optimum clips can be. Okay, then I figure out where I put the bolts in, try to make the clips reasonable for anybody's height, tall, short.
With the bolts in place, Mike is ready to redpoint his first descent.
Bubba, life is good.
The Black Velvet Canyon has some of the longest routes in the Red Rocks. These routes take boldness and commitment. A perfect place for Randy to find a traditional first ascent. Rather than place a bolt, Randy places small nuts in the soft sandstone. Randy likes this style. He's been climbing on this rock for years, and he's confident he won't fall.
It's pretty dramatic up here.
They're just not, you know, they're not like superficial placements. You gotta work to get these things. This one's bomber, though. I might as well clip into it.
God, it's just like holds galore. It's a typical Red Rock wonder.
Yeah, that's bomber though, actually. It's a better placement. That little flake broke out of there.
Higher, the wall steepens. Randy's protection becomes few and far between. Randy reaches the crux of the route and climbs it with marginal stoppers below his feet. Randy has succeeded in putting up a route that would be enjoyable for an experienced sandstone climber. To anyone else, this could be a scary climb.
Okay, here's the belay. I stand up and then I belay.
This route was established in traditional style, from the ground up, all natural protection, with bold runouts, like this section past the crux. Randy decided to make a safer climb for others to enjoy by adding two bolts. This gave him a chance to demonstrate traditional bolting technique.
First thing you want to do is kind of zen on the holds, right? Make sure you get your hole where you want it started right. Kind of old-fashioned by today's new style, which is definitely a different style. employing electric motor drills, but it's still valid in certain circumstances. You only have to place a couple holes here or there, and it definitely enables you to travel a little bit lighter, thereby taking on larger features, projects. Yeah, this is the old-fashioned dinosaur method of placing bolts, in the sense that it takes about 3 or 4 times longer at least to place one of these than it does with a Bosch or Hilti. But the most gratifying part is that when you're all done, you go just like this. Slack, Murray, and voila, protection once again.
If the rock is steep, it may be difficult to place a bolt on a natural stance.
Fuck, I'm back moving. Look, Jesus. Please, Murray.
If it's too difficult to let go with both hands, you can hang on a hook to place the bolt. This could be a dicey proposition, especially in soft rock like sandstone. Next, a hole is drilled. Electric drills are preferred over hand drills because they can drill a hole in less than a minute. No one wants to hang around on a hook for very long. Placing bolts on lead can be very scary, but this is part of the appeal for the first ascensionist. Unlike the security of rappel bolting, traditional bolting technique holds the thrill of adventure and the unknown.
Slack. Oh, victory. Man over the elements. Murray, what a great job you're doing.
Tanks for the last 10,000 years. Unfortunately, some visitors to the park have not respected Waco's cultural past. So far, climbers' impact to Waco has been minimal, but with the popularity of sport climbing, this could change. One of the reasons climbers love to climb here are the many holds and holes known as Wacos.
These are handholds and footholds that are unique to Waco, that they're as big as you could ever want, yet it's in a roof. So you get 25 feet of pure horizontal climbing, and in the end you'll find these are the biggest holds that you'll ever fall off of.
Came to Waco, it was quickly realized that a route could go up anywhere with a power drill. In an effort to protect the resources of the area, the Texas State Park banned climbing altogether. But local climbers worked with the state to create a new bolting policy. Now, bolts can be placed by state park approval only.
Empire of the Senseless was my first new route at Waco, and it was one of the first routes done there on the new approval system. It was a lot of work to get it approved, but it was really worth the hassle because it's a great route. Really nice moves, a nice steep wall, little edges, good climbing. In theory, the application process at Waco is good. There's important resources that need to be protected at the park, and I agree with that. Unfortunately, the bureaucracy is really slow, so it was a fight, lots of phone calls to get it approved. In other areas, you only fight yourself to do new routes. Just your ability is all that matters. At Waco, you have to fight the system and then fight yourself to get a new route done.
An approval process is necessary in a sensitive area like Waco. In other areas, government officials may not be as understanding. Ideally, climbers should work together and communicate with park officials, as opposed to having climbing banned for good. Some climbers just can't wait for route approval. Todd Skinner rigged Boys Town with a static line to protect the lead. Todd claims that this will be one of the hardest routes at Waco Tanks at 514A. Todd has been working on this route for weeks. Before he begins, he visualizes each move, each lunge, and each hold in vivid detail.
On the beginning, there's a fair bit of 512 and some 513 that you must go by as quickly as you can, since speed saves power for the end of the route. So as quickly as I could climb without making errors, I made my way up to a clipping position, which we named the Gold Pan because of its sloping nature. The clip from the Gold Pan is one of the most tenuous that I've ever been on, in that you're going to hit the ground if you make an error before you get the carabiner clipped. After clipping, the crux begins with a fair bit of dynamic lunging and some shoulder wrenching pops. You must be very, very careful with your feet. The feet are pulling as well as pushing on this route, so they're acting a little bit more like second and third hands for you, pulling on the end cut holds and assisting in the big lunges. There were two holds higher up on the route that I named the Spook Eyes, and I had a big bro set in the right one, which took any value that it had as a hold away from it, but provided me with a way to keep the static line in.
Okay, watch.
Yeah. And the last part of the route, which is a very, very technical section, needed so much power that it was a long time before my sequence was so polished that I had the right amount of power at the end.
Son of a bitch!
Walk in Spanish down the hall is a sort of PhD program in precision dynamics. What you're doing with your feet is sometimes precisely what you're doing with your hands. You're doing these dynamic movements back and forth, the tiny little crimps, the little edges. It's very powerful, very modern dance. It's a remarkable climb because it's sort of broken into two parts. The first comes precision and accuracy. The second part leans back even farther. It's very, very difficult, very pumping, and you have to go a ways above the bolt on this. So as soon as the holds get big and your forearms are swollen to huge size, you have to reach long distances between holds, dealing with big slopers and long dynamic throws. The way my arms feel now is exactly why I love this sport, so...
Well, as they say in the Highlander, it is better to burn out than to fade.
It was frustrating because it wasn't just powerful and it wasn't just an intellectual climb. It was a beautiful combination of both.
The Sea of Holes, a 300-foot face covered in Wacos. A few years ago, there was not much difference between soloing this climb and leading it. The route had only a few bolts and two pitches.
One down, one to go.
Today, the route has many more bolts. The Texas State Park bolting policy has allowed for the retro-bolting of unsafe routes and replacing bad anchors. Now this climb can be led safely. However, Jay Layden decided to climb without a rope, despite loose holds and high winds.
This wind's making the sea a little bit choppy.
Free soloing may be the purest form of climbing. It's just you and the rock. But the stakes are high. Every year, many climbers die or are injured while free soloing. To climb without a rope is a personal choice. Like the circus performer who works without a net, the free soloer must accept the outcome of a mistake. But you don't have to free solo to experience climbing in its purest form. Some of the best climbing in Waco is right off the ground.
Bouldering is the ideal sport for someone with a short attention span. When you boulder, you can do an awful lot of different type of climbing in one day. For me, bouldering, you know, it's maybe the ultimate individual pursuit when it comes to climbing. Not that climbing with a rope and a partner isn't terrific, but with bouldering, you test yourself and you can try over and over again and gauge how you get better or your progress. I think that with bouldering, it's more the individual and the rock.
I think it's too high.
you either get to the top or you don't. And so there's, in some ways it's almost proving something. If you can't do the problem, you can't do it, and you go and try something easier that's more in your ability. But if you can get to the problem, no one can take that away from you.
I'm not going to do it that way. Down. Okay, next time.
Right there. Yeah. You got it. Left hand. Come on.
Okay. Work it?
Yes. Nice. Good job.
Go ahead. Fire.
Yeah! Yay! Waco Tanks has, well, it's almost the ideal place to climb because there's so many different boulders that are remote that you can wander off on the trails, find a rock that you want to climb, know that the rock will be good, that the holds will be good, and the experience will be terrific. Do your best, get to the top of the rock, have, you know, a good pump into your arms, and feel the satisfaction, and then sit there and enjoy the beauty of the place.
So far, we've seen some impressive climbing in this video. Most of it has been bolt-protected face climbs. Hard crack climbs offer a different kind of challenge and require additional skills. Not only do you have to be sure your jams are good, but your protection must also be secure. On this climb, part of the challenge has been removed. Protection can be difficult and strenuous to place in thin cracks, but the protection in this crack is excellent.
You okay?
Yeah. Right from the start, I figured, okay, the bolts are wrong. If I climbed it and clipped them, I wouldn't be happy with my performance at all. And so I just made the decision that I wouldn't clip them, not sort of, okay, well, I'll see how it goes. If it gets real tough, then I'll start clipping them. It was just like, they weren't there as far as I was concerned. Myself, I really like the idea of having things that are impossible, that I cannot climb. I wouldn't like climbing so much if I could just climb anything. At least for some people who are getting into climbing and sort of told this is what climbing is all about, are maybe being shortchanged a bit, because I think there's a lot more to it than that. But for some people, they wouldn't get into climbing if they had to sort of take on the placing of protection and the lousy rock sometimes and the whole adventure part of it. They do just want a sport, just like tennis is a sport. I would hope that people getting into it come into it with their eyes open and with a mind to sort of being imaginative. I think it sort of goes along with the idea that there is a lot of diversity in climbing. I like to sort of sample it all. I think I would have to say that the big roots are my favorite thing. Sort of the closest thing to mountain climbing without having to wear big boots and carry big packs. But just, you know, the long approaches, you know, lots of climbing. At least some kind of isolation is preferable. Thank you.
Yankee Indian hunters had stumbled upon a place near what's now called Inspiration Point. They were the first non-Indians ever to enter the Yosemite Valley. Today, Yosemite National Park is entered by millions. There are those who come here strictly for recreation. And there are those who come as though on a pilgrimage for spiritual renewal. Most visitors' reasons for coming fall somewhere in between. Yosemite spreads over 1,170 square miles of western Sierra wilderness in the state of California. It is 350 miles from Los Angeles and 193 miles from San Francisco. It encompasses two rivers, 429 lakes, five major waterfalls, and groves of trees that are the largest living things on Earth. It was millions of years in the making. But millions of years aren't that long in geological time. Back further still, our birth pang planet was convulsed with fire. In time, some 4 billion years, the flowing lava slowed. Molten magma cooled, forming gentle landscapes. From pumice and ash came soil. And from soil grew vegetation. 25 million years ago, on the western margin of what we now call North America, a massive granite upthrust rose from the Earth's crust, a rising chunk of solid rock 400 miles long. We know it by the name Sierra Nevada, and it's rising still. Waters gathered. In an onrush of increasing power, the waters cut canyons as deep as 3,000 feet. The climate got colder. Huge coniferous trees began growing where less hardy vegetation was dying out. The immense upwarp of granite inched to the dizzy heights we see today. Wind-blown snows were lashed upon the summits, snows that never melted. More winters brought more new snows, impacted upon the old. Aging snows became ice. Ice coalesced into glaciers. And these vast glaciers would break from their moorings and grind down. Rivers froze. Great towering trees that forested the lowlands, sequoias, died where they stood. Flowers perished, not to bloom again for nearly a million years. This granite mass, this range, now sawtoothed and snow-covered, which is what Sierra Nevada means in Spanish, produced its very own ice ages. Glaciers moved, advancing and retreating, but always moving. Moving imperceptibly in human notions of time, but unstoppably. moving like gigantic chisels, riving the dense rock, moving over the granite like buffers, scouring and polishing, moving like the fingers of a sculptor in carving out a paradise of nature and in sculpting what may well be the most beautiful valley in the world. The last long winter had spanned thousands of years. Now it was spring again. But should we forget the force of glacial ice, we're reminded of it by rocks, boulders, towering granite walls, grooved and striated as though by gigantic claws. Should we forget the weight of these glaciers, 100 million tons, we're reminded by the fact that they polished whole cliffsides to the smoothness of glass. Should we forget the force of glacial waters, we see where gorges, ravines, great chasms have been sculpted by it. Should we forget that this land had been thick with forests of sequoias, the biggest living things on earth? Small groves of these great trees endure, defying change, defying time itself. Should we forget that before the creeping, crushing juggernaut of glaciers, regal beasts roamed here? From the family of monstrous prehistoric bears came the prowling black bear that we know today. From the saber-toothed tiger, the mountain lion. From the fierce dire wolf, the stealthy coyote. Now that flowing water had returned and warmth, this land was again a home for myriad forms of life. The mule deer, the raccoon, the acorn woodpecker, the yellow-bellied marmot, the tree squirrel and the ground squirrel, and the rattlers, and the red-tailed hawks that hunted them. And should we forget that this abundance of wildlife first drew human hunters some 4,000 years ago? These hunters and seed gatherers, these Adams and Eves of this American Eden, left us their spear points and these mortar holes where they had ground acorns into meal. Over tens of centuries, hunters and seed gatherers came and went. These primal people dwelt in harmony with their surroundings. They took what they needed. Compared with us, they lived in original innocence. In these last centuries, this land was settled by a Miwok people who saw the valley as Awani, a great gaping mouth. And these people became the Awanichi, the people of the gaping mouth. They attributed the land's creation to Coyote Man and Frog Man.
Coyote Man and Frog Man were afloat on a raft. Frog Man dove down into the water and came up with mud. Of this mud, Coyote Man made the land. Then he made us, the people. He made many different people who spoke and lived in different ways.
To the Awanichi, the valley was permeated by the Great Spirit. To them, the waterfalls cascaded with spirit life. Their hunters spoke with the spirits of the quarry that they stalked. They imitated the virtues of their fellow creatures of the lofty crags above the valley, the sure-footedness of the mountain sheep, the sharp sight of the peregrine falcon. The Awanichi lived in cone-shaped dwellings of bark built over fire pits. Black oaks were an important source of food. These were acorn gatherers. In autumn, each family gathered some 500 pounds of them. Acorns.